Hello, welcome to Bite Size Med. This video is on how vitamin D maintains calcium and phosphate homeostasis. A little background on vitamin D. It's both a vitamin and a hormone. It's a fat-soluble vitamin along with vitamins A, E, and K. The rest are water-soluble. There are two important forms of vitamin D, vitamin D2 and vitamin D3. D2 is ergocalciferol. D3 is cholecalciferol. How do you remember which is which? C is the third letter of the alphabet, that's vitamin D3. The two differ in their sources, but for this video, we need vitamin D3, that's cholecalciferol. It's synthesized in the skin. It can also come from diet, but mainly with the sun and skin. And vitamin D is needed for a lot of things, mostly for bone strength, but also for muscles to function properly, for immunity, among other things. For its work with calcium, vitamin D needs to be activated first. Now we're going to see how that happens in the body, and it involves three organs. Cholecalciferol is derived from cholesterol. So we'll start with 7-dehydrocholesterol. This is located in skin, so that's the first organ in the pathway, skin. Now it's common knowledge that you get vitamin D from the sun. That's because the first step of converting 7-dehydrocholesterol to cholecalciferol is by sunlight, the ultraviolet B rays in sunlight. This is vitamin D3, making 7-dehydrocholesterol pro-vitamin D3. In between, there is an intermediate called pre-vitamin D3, but this can all get a little confusing, so let's remove those. This cholecalciferol is what you can also get from dietary sources. But it's not active. This version of vitamin D is inactive. Now we need the second organ, that's the liver. The 7-dehydrocholesterol had one hydroxyl group. We're gonna add another one now. That's by a hydroxylase, which will add it at the 25th position. That's a 25-hydroxylase. This makes 25-hydroxycholecalciferol, or 25-hydroxyvitamin D3. Since now there are two hydroxyl groups, it's also called calciferol. Di is the two. This step needs cofactors like NADPH, oxygen, and magnesium. So magnesium is needed for vitamin D synthesis, and a magnesium deficiency can thus result in a vitamin D deficiency as well. It's still inactive. But this is the main circulatory form of vitamin D in plasma, and most of it is bound to an alpha globulin, a vitamin D binding protein. Since it's still not active, we need one more organ, the kidney. This is a very important step. We add another hydroxyl group at the first position. That's by a 1-alpha hydroxylase, giving us 1,25-dihydroxy, because there are two more now, cholecalciferol, or 1,25-dihydroxyvitamin D3, or calcitriol. The tri is 3. There were two hydroxyl groups, and now there are 3. So it's calcitriol. It can be abbreviated as 1,25-DHCC. This calcitriol is active vitamin D3. This is important for calcium absorption in the intestines, and I'll get to that. But again, this reaction needs the same cofactors, NADPH, oxygen, and magnesium. Now, active vitamin D is needed for calcium absorption. So if that is needed, active vitamin D is formed. But if there's enough calcium and that's not needed, the body chooses to instead hydroxylate a different position, again by the kidney, the 24th position, by a 24-hydroxylase. That forms 24,25-dihydroxycholecalciferol. This is inactive. So the 1,25 version is active. The 24,25 version is inactive. Now these can form metabolites, which are then excreted from the body. But this step, the 1-alpha hydroxylase step, is obviously very important. This is the rate-limiting step. Without that, there's no active vitamin D. So that is the step that is tightly regulated in the body by three main factors: calcium, phosphate, and the parathyroid hormone. There's also negative feedback here. So if there's too much active vitamin D, it can inhibit its own activation. But how would these three regulate this enzyme? For that, we'll see what vitamin D does in the body. To understand that, we need calcium. Calcium is taken in through diet. It reaches the small intestine, where it gets absorbed into the extracellular fluid. It also gets secreted in GI fluids, and the GI system is its main mode of excretion. From the ECF, calcium can exchange with cells, entering them and leaving them to perform its functions. Calcium gets deposited in bones, and bones serve as a reservoir, and thus by resorption, calcium can be removed from bones and put back into the ECF. A lot of that calcium also gets filtered by the kidneys, but most of it gets reabsorbed, leaving behind a very small amount to be excreted in the urine. Vitamin D acts on these three organs, the small intestine, the kidney, and bone, to maintain calcium and phosphate homeostasis. But the main site of action is the small intestine. So how does vitamin D work here? Let's assume this is an intestinal cell, the enterocyte. This is the lumen, and here we have blood and capillaries. Between the cell and the capillary is interstitial fluid. An exchange between interstitial fluid and plasma happens across the capillary membranes. To make it easier, we remove the capillary. This is the apical membrane, and this is the basolateral membrane. Calcium is absorbed by two methods, the paracellular pathway and the transcellular pathway. The paracellular pathway is between the cells, and this isn't influenced by vitamin D. The transcellular pathway goes through the cell. This is where vitamin D can act. The calcium gets taken up by the cell through calcium channels and then pumped out of the cell by active transporters. There's a calcium ATPase pump that sends calcium out against its gradient using ATP, and a sodium-calcium exchanger which exchanges sodium for calcium. It's very similar to calcium reabsorption in the kidney, but here we aren't reabsorbing it, we're just absorbing it because this is the small intestine. The movement of calcium into the cell is because of an electrochemical gradient. The chemical part of this is that it's moving from a high concentration to low concentration. So now where does vitamin D come in here? It acts on the nucleus of the cell. What does it do here? Calcitriol, which is our active vitamin D, activates the vitamin D receptor. This is a nuclear receptor. This forms a heterodimer with the retinoid X receptor, and the complex then binds to the vitamin D response element of the cell's DNA. There's transcription and translation, resulting in the synthesis of proteins. Basically, it acts on the nucleus and synthesizes proteins. What are those proteins? The channels that take up calcium, alkaline phosphatase, and a calcium-binding protein called calbindin. Obviously, by placing more channels here, it can increase calcium absorption. Calbindin binds to calcium, so by vitamin D synthesizing calbindin, it's supposed to actually buffer calcium entering the cell. That leaves lesser free calcium inside the cell, maintaining that high to low gradient. That ensures that more calcium can be taken up by the cell and increases calcium absorption. Calcitriol thus increases calcium absorption. But what about phosphate? Phosphate gets taken up by a sodium phosphate cotransporter. Calcitriol upregulates this transporter. More transporters, more phosphate absorption. So it can increase both calcium and phosphate absorption. That's on the small intestine, but what about bone? Vitamin D can have direct and indirect effects on bone. The indirect effect is more important, and that uses what we just learned. By absorbing more calcium and phosphate from the intestines, it increases the solubility product of these ions, making them precipitate, which mineralizes bone. So the indirect effect would be bone mineralization. We know we need vitamin D for mineralizing bones. We've been learning that part forever. The direct effect is supposed to be similar to the parathyroid hormone. Most of this stuff is actually not fully understood, but this is what I picked up when I read about it. The bone-forming cells, that's the osteoblasts, they have receptors for vitamin D, just like the parathyroid hormone. When vitamin D binds to its receptor, the osteoblasts produce cytokines, like the macrophage colony stimulating factor and the RANK ligand. They activate osteoclast precursor cells to become mature osteoclasts, that then go and resorb bone, releasing calcium and phosphate into the extracellular fluid. So by bone resorption, it can increase calcium and phosphate in the extracellular fluid. That seems like the complete opposite of the indirect effect. It's breaking down bone here. And isn't vitamin D supposed to strengthen bones? One explanation I could find for how this could work is that it's resorbing old bone, putting that calcium and phosphate into the extracellular fluid so that it can mineralize new bone, thus helping with bone remodeling. But like I said before, the indirect effect is more important. The last organ is the kidney. For calcium, PTH and vitamin D work synergistically, meaning they work together to increase calcium reabsorption. How they do that differs, but vitamin D does this by protein synthesis like it did in the small intestine. But on phosphate, the actions of the two are the opposite. It increases those transporters like it did in the small intestine, so it increases phosphate reabsorption and reduces its excretion. Unlike PTH, which reduces phosphate reabsorption and thus increases its excretion. The overall effects of vitamin D by acting on all three organs is to increase the ECF calcium and phosphate. So if the calcium is low, we need more active vitamin D to absorb more. Same with phosphate. Low calcium and low phosphate would thus stimulate 1-alpha hydroxylase to produce more active vitamin D. PTH also stimulates this enzyme. Its goal is similar. It wants to increase plasma calcium. So it does that indirectly by activating vitamin D, which can then absorb calcium from the intestines. So there's calcium, phosphate, PTH, and vitamin D itself, which can regulate this enzyme. A little application here. In a deficiency of vitamin D, there would not be good absorption of calcium and phosphate, resulting in bone mineralization problems in addition to other things. In children, that is rickets when it affects growing bones, though there are lots of types of rickets. Vitamin D deficiency is a cause of rickets. In adults, there can be softening of bones. That's called osteomalacia. That's a start to learning about disorders associated with vitamin D. But all of this was how vitamin D works with PTH to maintain calcium and phosphate homeostasis. I do hope this video was helpful. If it was, you can give it a like and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.